Thank you so much, everyone, for joining the section. So today we're going to be talking about building with accessibility in mind. A brief introduction about myself. My name is Amecha Marachi. I'm a front-end developer and I'm also a technical writer. Because of time, let's go straight to what we have for today. So our talk goes for today, we're going to be talking about what is accessibility? We're going to be looking at some accessibility terms. I'm going to talk about a short story to help us understand accessibility better. Then we're going to be talking about principles of accessibility and resources to help you get started. And also we're going to be talking about tools for testing accessibility. Now let's talk about what is accessibility. Accessibility is the inclusive practice of ensuring There are no barriers that prevent interactions with or an access to a website, not just a website, an application, by people with physical disabilities, situational disabilities, and socioeconomic restriction on bandwidth and speed. So broadly speaking, when we say site is accessible, we mean that the contents of the website or the application, the content is available and the functionality is also available and can be operated by literally anyone. Now moving on to the next slide, let's talk about some accessibility terms we may have come across or some terms we're going to see as time goes on. First is A11i. A11i is a short form of accessibility. So you often see it on social media as hashtag A11i. So A11i is created by combining the first letter of accessibility, which is A. The 11 stands for the 11 letters between the first and the last letter of accessibility, and the Y stands for the last letter of accessibility. Then the second accessibility term here, it's I18n, which stand for internationalization. So the short form of internationalization is IATN, and it is created by combining I, which is the first letter of internationalization, 18, which is the 18 letter between the first and the last letter of internationalization, and N, which is the last letter of internationalization. Then our third accessibility term we have here is AT, and AT is assistive technology. Assistive technology is any device or software equipment that actually help people work around their challenges. Fourth, we have disability. So simply, disability is just a limitation in ability. Research shows that 1 in 5 people have disability. If you don't build with accessibility in mind, you could be excluding 20% of your potential users, customers, students, and many more when you don't build with accessibility in mind. Let's look at this image here. This image is showing 3 able bodies. And then when you build or you make your application accessible for everyone, this additional person here is a blind person. And because we made our application accessible to anyone, the person adds to the users, and because of this, your platform gets more users. And we all know that more users is equivalent to more success. It's also equivalent to more revenue. Now, let's look at the short story I have for today, and let's talk about why we have got so much work to do. This is a family. They built a house. And when they were building the house, they didn't build this house with accessibility in mind. And then they are trying to move in from their old house into their new house. And here is their son saying, "Mommy, we have an elephant in our old house. How is he going to move into this place? The door is tight, the door is narrow, and there's no way an elephant could pass here." And they were thinking of another alternative, or a best alternative that will actually assist or help the elephant to move into the house with them. And then what they did was they operated the tree, planted it here, and they broke the door and expanded it. What would have happened if this family had actually considered or built this house with accessibility in mind? This would have been the outlay if they've considered accessibility from the start. You can see the difference between when, if they have considered accessibility from start, and what happened when they didn't consider accessibility from the start. You can see that the difference is clear. So now let's talk about, even if you're a developer, even if you're a designer, even if you're a founder, it's our responsibility to ensure that accessibility doesn't start in phase two. Accessibility should start from the onset of when a project commences. Principles of accessibility. What are the principles of accessibility? One, accessibility should be passive. It should be perceivable. Users must be able to process information gotten from the web. And information is not accessible if the user cannot process it. The perceivable principle of accessibility states that users should be able to perceive information using one or more of their senses. For example, let's look at a YouTube video. Probably I'm watching a Chinese movie on YouTube, and because they are speaking Chinese, I'm enjoying the movie, but I'm not understanding or I'm not hearing what they are saying. But if caption is provided for that movie, I should be able to use my eyes to read whatever is being provided there, which is probably English. But if caption is not provided, I'll probably just be hearing the Chinese, which I might not be able to perceive or understand what it's going on there. So when you are building, you should make sure that your website or your application is perceivable to all users. Now, operable, which is the second principle of accessibility. So people with disabilities should be able to operate web pages and application with a variety of tools. If a user cannot operate our website or our application with a mouse, which happens, there are some people who have maybe problems with hands and all that, and there are some people who use keyboard to navigate through an application. So if a user cannot operate our website or our application with a mouse, then a keyboard-based operation should be implemented. Users should also be able to control elements on the web page, no matter the tool or assistive technology they are using. Now, understandable. The content on the web page or application must be understandable to all users. Users should be able to understand the information on the web page. Also, if a user can actually perceive and also operate a website, that doesn't mean that they can actually understand it. An understandable website uses clear and concise language and also limits confusion and ambiguity. It is also comprehensible, and the functionality is easy to understand. Now let's talk about the fourth and the last principle of accessibility, which is robust. The fourth and the last principle, which is robust. Websites should be compatible across all platforms, devices, and browser. The web content should be compatible with current and future software and tools. A wide range of technology can also access the content on the web page without any limitation. One of the best ways to actually meet the principle of robustness is to be consistent, follow standard and convention when building for users. Now let's look at making accessible content, best practices, and quick wins. One, provide captions or written transcript for a video content. Use logical headings and proper structuring. If you're building like a web page, you use H1. Don't use the H1 that is for title for the footer. Just use the logical heading and the proper structuring. Make sure that the link text describes the purpose of the link. Use meaningful descriptive alt on images. Don't just say a cat. You can use meaningful description by saying, oh, the cat is sitting on the wall or something similar. Provide controls options on video, GIF, and carousels. Ensure that all form controls have an appropriate label associated with them. So because of time, let's quickly look at steps to get started supporting accessibility. One, you learn accessibility deeply. Yeah, so I will encourage everyone here in this section, after the talk, go home, or we're already home already, sorry. After the talk, take time out and learn accessibility deeply. Two, once you finish learning accessibility, then you implement testing tools into your workflow. And we'll look at some of the accessibility testing tools you can actually implement into your workflow. 3, user testing is the best testing. 4, you tell a friend about accessibility. And 5, repeat the process. Now, resources to help you get started with accessibility. Google provided the web accessibility course, which is free, so you can check it out. We have the A11i project. We have the Web AIM, which is the Web Accessibility in Mind, and we have the Web Accessibility Initiative. So these are all websites. You can just check out them on Google. And tools for testing accessibility, we have WAVE. So WAVE stands for Web Accessibility Evaluation Tool. It's an accessibility evaluation tool from Web AIM, which is the Web Accessibility in Mind. Then we have TOTA.A11i, which is an accessibility visualization toolkit. And then we have ACE. ACE is the accessibility engine. It's a JavaScript library that executes automated accessibility testing inside your testing framework or browser of choice. And then we have PA11i. PA11i, it's like an automated testing PAL. And that's it. We have come to the end of the section, and I'll be ending my section today with a question for you to answer at your own time. And the question is, would you build a bridge that only a specific car or a specific type of car can use? So in relation to accessibility, I'll be asking, would you build a product, would you build an application that only a specific type of people can use? If the answer to this question is no, then you should consider accessibility and consider building with accessibility from henceforth. Thank you.